So what is critical thinking? That's an excellent question that I am not going to answer for you. Critical thinking is one of those things that virtually all faculty say that we want to teach, that we value, that is one of those critical skills, right, and habits of mind that we hope to instill in our students before graduation. But when you probe many faculty members and ask them what exactly is critical thinking other than thinking critically, it's a very, very difficult thing to put your finger on. So we will spend some time talking about definitions and in particular how critical thinking is implemented and or practiced in different disciplinary contexts. But I wanted to start out today by talking about the importance of critical thinking at UH-Manoa and its evolving recognition, right, in how undergraduate education is conceived of and implemented on our campus. It is one of the major areas that under the Manoa Faculty Senate, right, we are tasked with incorporating into our undergraduate curriculum across campus and across disciplinary boundaries. And it is one of the five major pillars of undergraduate education according to WASC, right? So on the WASC Reaccreditation Steering Committee, for example, Monica and I are participating in discussions, thinking very hard about how we can demonstrate that critical thinking is incorporated into and assessed, right, at UH-Manoa. Unlike many other mainland institutions, critical thinking is not an explicit part of the general education curriculum, right? So many of our peer and benchmark institutional partners on the mainland have the equivalent of a critical thinking focus designation, right? And faculty apply to have that designation added to their courses, students take them, they check off the box, and there you go, right? They've had training in critical thinking. We don't do that here. Right, but what we do have, right, is an increasing and growing focus on how critical thinking is incorporated into, in particular for me, the general education curriculum, right? So how the particular habits of mind, research, training, right, the use of logic, right, and both inferential and deductive reasoning in writing intensive courses, how critical thinking is practiced in contemporary ethical reasoning classes and oral communication classes, in FGA and FGB classes, et cetera. Of course, critical thinking happens outside of the general education curriculum as well. It has been identified as one of the central areas that we can see, right, elements of being incorporated into program learning outcomes, right, across the curriculum. So I was a part of the critical thinking working group that was tasked with figuring out how to assess the extent to which critical thinking is incorporated across the campus in 2011 and 2012. And one of the ways we did this was by deciding on a definition, right, of critical thinking. And then taking that definition with a variety of keywords and doing a survey of program learning outcomes across the entire undergraduate curriculum at UH-Manoa. And we found that a surprisingly high proportion of program learning outcomes include explicit references to elements of critical thinking, which was really heartening. And so clearly people consider the various elements of critical thinking important, right? Critical, if you will, to their undergraduate majors and programs of study. It's also a key portion of our undergraduate institutional learning outcomes, or learning objectives, rather, and again, part of the umbrella piece, right, in terms of the learning objectives and purpose, right, and place of general education within an undergrad's experience at UH-Manoa.
We've evaluated students' perceptions, whether they think they're learning about critical thinking, and we've also evaluated their actual student products. So the good news is students believe that they are learning about critical thinking, and we know this because when we asked them in 2015 via the National Survey of Student Engagement, 72% of the seniors reported a frequent activity or substantial learning related to critical thinking. That's very good. I will note, however, that that is below our peers. Our peer institutions, their students were higher than 75%. When we looked at actual student work, we found room for improvement. We were not quite happy or satisfied with the results. Only 44% of the students met expectations. And on the value rubric that you have in your packet, what that means in terms of the score, it means that students were on average scoring about 2 or lower on that critical thinking value rubric. So again, we have room for improvement. So we're going to evaluate critical thinking again this semester. And if you're teaching a class that has seniors and you assign students work that asks them to demonstrate some kind of critical thinking, I'm going to ask you for your student work. And what we'll do is we'll redact it. We'll anonymize it so the faculty who score it won't know who the professor is or who the student is. And then we aggregate the results. And then we report them out, as I just did, 44%. We hope to see in our next round a higher percentage of students meeting our expectations. And if you will participate, I will give you a book. I brought some books here today that pertain to critical thinking, and we'll give you one of these two books, hard copy. But I will also let you know that both of these books are available complete online as a digital copy available through Hamilton Library. And the information is in the resources section on your handout. So our goals for you today, we really hope that you leave being able to do two things. One is describe a type of critical thinking that you want your students to be able to achieve. And also, we want you to have developed either an idea or a rough sketch of an assignment that will tap into students' critical thinking skills and help them develop into better thinkers. And of course, if you can participate, we'll be very happy. I'll let Christine introduce our first activity.
So we're gonna ask you to do something called pink hair share. So if you can get together with another faculty member and spend a minute or two jotting down a brief description of a critical thinking activity within your particular disciplinary field, right? And then spend 2 or 3 minutes sharing it with each other. That would be great. And then we'll call you back together as a group. So you get a sense, right, hopefully from these brief conversations that critical thinking as it's implemented within the disciplines is highly variable, right? It's the disciplinary context, right, that gives it flesh, right?
Yeah.
That allows us to think about what it means to be a critical thinker in an electrical engineering class as opposed to an art history class, for example.
Yep, because if you were like the pair I was in, we had very different activity or very different types of thinking that we wanted our students to engage in. Both are valid. They just come from our course goals and our disciplinary perspectives. So keep that thinking in mind and see if that's the type of thinking you want to work on for your assignment that we're going to help create or work on creating later. Let me give you some information about what we know from research regarding critical thinking. One very important thing to know is that critical thinking is not one thing. So we can't tell students that we want them to think critically. We need to be more specific because critical thinking is actually a set of processes that take you to a goal, an informed outcome or an action or a conclusion. And it's definitely context dependent and disciplinary specific. And on your handout on the first page, there's 5 different ways of defining critical thinking. But what these share is that It involves a set of mental or cognitive activities that's purposeful. These are all types of critical thinking elements. So if you use any of these words in your descriptions of assignments or your student learning outcomes, you are actually asking students to engage in a critical thinking process. Here's some general principles. There's groups of people doing research on critical thinking, and they've all concluded that it's hard to teach and it's hard to learn. And one of the most important things to know is that it's hard to learn because of something called belief preservation and bias and blind spots. Now, as faculty, we might be less inclined to have belief preservation because we've been trained to question our own beliefs. But definitely for our students, belief preservation dominates. For faculty, what dominates for us is blind spots. And that's because as experts in the field, we automatically chunk things together because we are so good at things. So for example, when I read something, I can very quickly read something and make sense of it and tie it into the literature because I've done that so many times. But students, when they approach a piece of difficult reading, it takes them a very long time and they actually don't know how to start reading. And they don't know how to tie it to the literature because they're just not familiar enough with it. But we as experts often forget how many steps we are taking to achieve something because we automatically do all the steps at the same time. Does that make sense? So it's really important for us to break down things that we want students to do, like analyze. Break that down. What does it mean? What are the steps involved in analyzing something if you're a novice? It's really hard for us to do, but please try to do it because you'll see great progress from your students if you can help them break it down and do the steps needed in order to achieve analysis. These four things are in your handout. Let me just touch on them briefly. We know that you cannot expect students to become critical thinkers or to think in the way we want through immersion or osmosis or serendipity. We have to actually point out to students examples of the thinking that we're looking for and help them understand why it's what we're looking for. And I find models are the best way to do this, or think aloud protocols, meaning that I actually think aloud to them as I observe something. I tell them everything I'm thinking. And I say, this is how you evaluate. And I show them by thinking out loud. Okay? Explicit instruction is necessary. Deliberate practice. As I said, thinking is hard. So you can help students by focusing their attention on a task and giving them tasks aimed to improve. We often give tasks to students so we can evaluate them, you know, give them a grade. But I encourage you to think about tasks just designed for student improvement. So this is another way of doing assessment for learning, not assessment of learning. And then give them feedback on how they're doing. 1 to 2 points, don't overwhelm them. 1 to 2 pieces of timely feedback are better than 3 pages of your copious notes. Practice in context. This is incredibly important. The other thing we know from research, besides the fact that we need explicit instruction and deliberate practice, is that teaching abstract rules of thinking are difficult for students to apply by themselves. So the best way to teach thinking is to give them the general rule or the abstract rule and then show them exactly how to apply it in different contexts. The more practical, the better. And this also connects to explicit instruction in transfer, because humans, it's very interesting, humans cannot transfer knowledge very well. We just can't. I'll give another whole workshop on why we can't do that, because it's fascinating research. So to help students transfer their knowledge, what they learn in one setting to the next, you have to show them examples and counterexamples. Here's when we should do this kinds of thinking. Here's when we should evaluate and use these rules. And here's when it's inappropriate to use these rules. So English 100, for example, is what all students are required to take for writing. And they learn certain ways of writing. And those ways of writing, those ways of thinking about writing, do not apply in all future situations. The classic example is they're learning to write in English, often for humanities type writing and not science genres. So they don't know how to write a lab report or a literature review in the social sciences after English 100. They don't know how to apply what they learned in English 100 to the literature review or to the science lab report by themselves. But you can help them make those connections. And you can do it through something called metacognitive questioning. So you can ask students before they start an assignment, what did you learn in the past, or maybe at home, or in your personal life, or in your community life, that you think you can apply to this assignment? Why do you think that will work? And then during the assignment, you can ask them questions about, hey, how's it going? Is your strategy working? Do you need to change your strategy? And at the end, you can have them reflect on what strategies worked and didn't work, and then ask them the really important question, when can you use this thinking strategy again? In what new circumstance? Those types of questions and your examples of how to apply across different contexts will really help students become more able to think in the ways that you want them to and in appropriate circumstances. Specifically related to your assignment design, keep these things in mind. So be explicit in the type of thinking you want. Use words that really describe it concisely, and then tie that to the learning outcome and the grading criteria, so everything's aligned. This helps prevent student confusion. Aim slightly above what students can do by themselves. This will help them improve. Give them a task that's slightly out of reach. Make it meaningful beyond the immediate classroom. This not only helps with motivation, but it also helps them see how thinking is used in different circumstances. Start with low stakes assignments, meaning they're not worth a lot of a grade percentage for the course. And use low stakes assignments as building blocks to get to a more complex assignment. And Christine and I have examples of that. And then again, use these metacognitive activities. Think about questions you can ask students to make them more aware of what thinking processes are going on. And if you get students to share amongst themselves, then they'll see that how they did something is not the only way to do it. And they can learn from peers, and they can also learn from you if you share how you approach a task. This book in particular, it's available at our library as a hard copy, also in my office. It's filled with probably 100 low stakes assignments that you can do in class to encourage students to think the way you want them to think. And it's the best part about this book is you don't have to read it from start and finish. You can open up almost anywhere and start reading and get value out of it. So this one is called Classroom Assessment Techniques. It's a great book. This book, Engaging Ideas by John Bean, this has a lot of really good contextualized and practical assignments. Both of these books give you examples from multiple fields, so you really get a rich resource by looking at either of these books. Critical thinking value rubric, it's in your handout. How you can use this is you can use it to evaluate student work, you can modify it and use it to evaluate student work, or you can just use some of the language to help you describe to students in your assignments and in class how thinking works, because faculty did a good job creating this rubric.
Okay, so for the next quick activity, I'm going to give you an example of an assignment that I've been working on for about 13 years now, and ask you to break it down, to unpack it. So I've been teaching writing intensive classes for a long time, and you know, it is an incredible amount of work, right, to teach writing intensive classes. One of the hallmarks of a WI class is providing feedback to students and giving them an opportunity to revise their writing. And so one of the techniques that I've been using is peer review, right? So I had started out giving a series of papers, right, in my classes, and I would provide detailed feedback, right, on the first two papers, and then for the final paper, I also incorporated peer review. So I told them, look at the feedback that I gave you, right? We've talked about higher order concerns versus lower order concerns, revision versus editing, right? I've used for a long time this analogy of a cake, right? Imagine you want to make a birthday cake and you don't have a recipe. You've got to figure out the recipe for the cake first before you start worrying about the frosting, right, and decorations. And so, you know, ignore the grammatical mistakes, ignore, right, the awkward phrasing, the kinds of small editing minutiae, right, that students tend to focus on, and focus on the central claim, its fit with the evidentiary support, the use and treatment of sources, the analyses of data and examples, your statements about limitations of your research, your conclusions, your introduction, as framing pieces, etc. So I thought when I first started doing this, all right, I'm doing a good job scaffolding. They have a sense of the kinds of things they're supposed to be focusing on. I've given them now two rounds of feedback on papers. And so I told them, all right, you're going to peer review each other. Here's how you're pairing up. Go. How do you think they did? Oh, yeah, they bonded. they you know, focused on grammar and awkward phrasing and praising each other because they've been sitting in a classroom together, right, for 3 months at that point. And, you know, oh, I love this. And, you know, this is so wonderful. Maybe you can do a little tweak here and there. And you know, I don't think it was for lack of effort. I think it was for lack of explicit instruction, right, that helped them to do the kinds of critical thinking that I'm asking for. So what I'm asking you to do for the next few minutes is to unpack, right, what's involved in peer review, right? Either when you're asking your students to review each other's papers, or equally relevant is when you engage in peer review, right? When a journal or a grant aid agency sends you something to peer review, what are the mental processes you're going through in providing constructive critical feedback? Have that discussion for a few minutes. So I'm going to call you back together. Can I ask for a couple of examples? What are the kinds of critical thinking skills or elements that go into peer review? What else? What am I missing? I mean, what you have in front of you is the simplified version, right, of the assignment. So instead of just telling them,
you're going to provide feedback, right? I tried to direct early in this process, right? These are the kinds of things I want. This is how you're going to do it, et cetera. And the quality of their peer reviews went up marginally, right? But still very, very far from satisfactory. So over time, I ended up developing not just a much more rigorous kind of assignments, but also a set of scaffolded classroom activities that built up to this, right? Where I paid explicit attention to some of the kinds of skills that I wanted them practicing in order to work up to the peer review, right? So we spent time going through reverse outlines, right? We had modeling exercises, right? I realized that in expecting students, particularly students who do not come from my discipline, I teach in the Latin American and Iberian Studies program. There isn't a single major on campus, right, that feeds directly into that. So I get business students and art history students and anthropology students and Spanish majors and engineers, et cetera, all sitting together in a classroom. And for them, what constitutes active reading, particularly because these are 300 and 400 level classes, right? The kinds of active reading strategies that they've been doing within their own majors is very different than what I'm asking them to do, right? In my interdisciplinary courses. So I had to start introducing them, right, to what it means to be an active reader of an archaeology journal article, right, which is incredibly complicated. So I started modeling for them, like Monica does. Okay, let's just read a random paragraph, right? This is what's going through my head. These are the connections that I'm making, right? These are the kinds of connections that I want you to be thinking of, right, with your limited disciplinary knowledge. I had to spend some classroom time, right, and put together an activity to teach them how to write a decent central claim, right? What a decent central claim is, where it falls within a rhetorical argument in archaeology, is completely different, right, than the disciplines that they're coming from. And so I learned to pull examples of journal articles, for example, from a wide variety of fields and show them, right, look, right, this is where it is in English literature, right, look, this is where it is in Filipino studies, right, look, this is where it is in an electrical engineering journal article. Now let's pull out the central claims and see what are the characteristics of central claims in each of these different disciplinary contexts that makes it publishable, right? That makes it concise, that makes it specific, that makes it testable, et cetera. I have to do the same thing for the use of sources, right? How do you use a quote? How do you contextualize that quote? What about disciplines where quoting, right, someone else's words is almost never done, right? How are sources dealt with in some of the natural and life sciences, right, for example? It's very, very different, right, than an analysis of poetry, right, or a different kind of literature review from a social science discipline. And so unpacking, right, what it meant to focus on higher order concerns, threatens to fill the rest of my semester, right? So you can see that, you know, once you start diving into one kind of peer review assignment, you really have to think very carefully about how to set them up for success. At the same time, right, that you're showing them that the kinds of skills that you're giving them are not confined to writing an archaeology paper for this professor who, thank God, I'm never taking again. Right, I want them leaving, you know, saying I'm ready for that communicology course, I'm ready for that marketing course, right? Because I know that central claims are going to look different, and I know how to figure out, right, how they're different. I know that I'm going to be using sources like quotes, right, very differently, but I know how to figure out how, right, to use them differently in this different disciplinary context. So what you have in front of you is a much more detailed assignment. It's not that I'm recommending you give huge long assignments to your students, but it is much more specific, right, than the first version in terms of the kinds of thinking, the kinds of practices, the kinds of protocols that allow for peer-reviewed exchanges to happen, that will in turn, right, feed our ultimate goal of improving student writing.
Let me move on to another example, different kind of example. So in my research methods class, I wanted an assignment that would be meaningful beyond the classroom, and so I was using a research proposal. It's a 400 level class, and to develop the research proposal assignment, which you have a modified version here on the blue sheet, I thought about what I knew from past experience students had difficulty doing. So I did that activity that you guys just did with Christine's peer review assignment, in which you started a brainstorm thinking about what does it take to be successful in peer review. I said, what does it take to be successful writing a research proposal? What are all the skills? What is all the knowledge that students need? And then I took it one step further and I asked myself, well, what do students repeatedly have trouble with? What do I know they struggle with? And for those items, I paid special attention. And so you'll see on my activities and item due dates list, the things that my students were having trouble with. The first thing that they were having trouble with was the library, reading, and knowing how to take notes in order to write a literature review, and knowing how to take notes in order to validate the methodology that they were proposing for their research study. So I would have to work with these 400 level students on note taking and reading skills, and I would do it through modeling. I would show them how I take notes, how I approached reading, and again, I use that think aloud. And they were shocked at how I read. So I encourage you to try it with your students. They were very shocked because I think many of them still have the notion that reading is understanding the words on the page instead of reading for a purpose and engaging in a conversation and reading purposefully. They really didn't get that yet. So that was the first thing. Another very important thing that they had trouble with was, what is the significance of their study? Why is their study important? That they were, why, so what? So I have a whole section in class where they do activities related to how do you determine your study significance? How do you talk about it? You know, the 3-minute speech in the elevator. Research design was so important that I have actually one-on-one conferences. And this class is only 20 to 25 students, so I have that luxury. So that was a one-on-one conference to verify the research design. And then I use peer review too. So on page 2, you then see the standards, and then I do give them a rubric. I give them annotated models of student work from previous semesters. The annotation is very important. Again, make explicit what type of thinking you're looking for in this other pieces of student work. Does that make sense? So for example, if I'm looking for a literature review that's a synthesis, not a summary, I point out areas of the student's literature review to say, this is why this is synthesis, this is not summary. So I point that out to them. Sections that are summary, sections that are synthesis, and so forth. Activity 3, you can, if you want, just start doing your own assignment and think about a product that the students are going to create that shows you the type of thinking that you're interested in. Think about explicitly linking this assignment to your learning outcomes and the evaluation criteria. Could be a rubric, could be something else. Think about one low-stakes assignment or one building block assignment that will help students be able to complete that, either a bigger project or a more complex project or a graded project. Like for me, you know, I have them do things like the conference and peer sharing and so forth. Those are building blocks. Come up with at least one metacognitive question that the students could ask, okay? And if you're not able to just start working on your assignment, of course, I provided you with 7 questions to consider. These are optional questions. Only do those questions if you're feeling stuck. Those questions are for you to, you know, help generate ideas. But if you already got ideas, just go for it. Start working on your own assignment. Okay, so take about 5 minutes to do the assignment. See how far you get, and then that will give you about 10 minutes to peer share, and then we'll come back together and wrap up. If you want me or Christine to give feedback or come talk with you, let us know.
I hope it's been helpful. So, you clearly don't have time in 10 minutes to develop a whole assignment, but if we've got you thinking about ways to scaffold, right, to build up to an assignment, to pay explicit attention in your class, right, to the skills, right, to the habits of mind that students will need in order to be successful on your particular assignment or your particular activity, then hopefully it's helpful. Can I just offer one more suggestion to you? In the spirit of paying it forward, you can see in one of those handouts, Monica's 4-page handout, that, where did it go? Here it is, thank you. At the bottom of the first page, you have examples of critical thinking related student learning outcomes. If you take a quick look at your own program's learning outcomes, there's a pretty good chance, right, that you'll find some element of critical thinking in there. Can I ask you to consider, right, asking for about a half hour of a faculty meeting sometime in the not too distant future where you get together with your colleagues and talk about ways that particular element, right, of critical thinking is being implemented in your classes. Right. We see our colleagues every day. We talk to them every day about everything but, right, how we are specifically addressing our program learning outcomes. Right. I suggest this not in the spirit of assessment, although it's very important. We all love assessment.
Assessment is about teaching and learning. Assessment is about conversations about teaching and learning. That's what assessment's about. So.
Well, then I do suggest the spirit of assessment. Yep. But because it's an opportunity, right, for you to talk to your colleagues about, okay, so how are you doing this kind of stuff in your classes? How are you talking about it? What vocabulary are you using? What specific skills, right, are you using? We're all complaining about how lousy our students are at fill in the blank, right? So how can we collaborate or maybe align our vocabulary or think about, even telling our students, this is the kind of thing, what we're working on right now, today, in this class, this is the kind of thing you're also going to be using in that class, right? Or in that class, or that's critical to being successful, right, with a degree in our department. So these are the kinds of conversations that, if I can gently suggest, you think about incorporating into a faculty meeting at some point, right? And it helps with the cohesiveness.
Yeah,
right?
It helps with the
delivery of the curriculum.
It improves the student experience. So again, please, before you leave, pick up the yellow sheet and help us out there. Thank you. You can either leave it on the table or on the back. Does anyone have any questions that they would like us to answer? We are available now and in the future. So thanks again for coming, and enjoy the rest of your day, and we will be in touch.
Thank you.
Aloha.